The Think Tank is a club set to motivate, innovate, and create.
We not only show you the path, but also guide you down the road.
It's a club that believes in challenging the ways of society.
A local community, welcoming people from diverse backgrounds and cultures.
We believe in the power of ideas to change lives and ultimately the world.
We're a club that broadens people's horizons and ideals.
A club that ignites your spark, guiding you throughout.
We're a small community of people who don't think alike at all.
And that's what makes us different.
We will now be starting a fireside chat with Dilip Chhabria.
Right, to start off with, sir, I believe this is the first time for you in Manipal.
Not really. I came on a very brief visit in 2004, actually, 2005, at one of your tech fests that I inaugurated.
Okay.
But in that sense, it's the first time I'm really spending so much time, and first time I visit, I've gone around your university. It's very impressed, of course.
Any comments about the infrastructure facilities of the universities that when you go into?
It's a huge number, and to sustain the quality of education and to sustain the brand. MIT, I think it's a job extremely well done, and I would expect you to, you know, sustain it in the future as well. But congratulations, I think it's a fantastic organization.
Thank you, sir. And we had a visit to the Formula Manipal, Robo Manipal, the Solar Mobile, and Project Manas. What is your comments about it?
In fact, I was just sharing some of the observations with my wife in the afternoon. And I'm quite, my observations are that the students in your college are exceedingly enthusiastic and raring to go. I think they're also keyed in on what's happening in the world. I would think that you need to empower them with a lot more resources that they would expect, because I see that they're very, very, they're leaders. I can sense that, at least with the labs that I saw. They are true leaders. They know what they want to do. They know where they're going.
Yes.
They are very knowledgeable. And so that's something fantastic.
Well, Manipal, college life, that should strike you something back in those days about your college?
Yeah, but I don't think I'd like to make that comparison because I never really went to class to study. And you know, I don't think these kids would be in the same realm. But whether in my college in India or abroad, at that impressionable age, you have a lot of distractions, and they have a lot more distractions these days than I ever had. So you learn most of the things at the job, which I was telling you in the afternoon. But I think the good thing is that so much of information they can glean from so many other sources. But having said that, of course, I think they are very fortunate that they are part of MIT and they would know that and they would give it that seriousness.
It's really nice. But that statement, I think that was truly inspiring to these people.
Yeah.
Isn't it, guys? I was not in college for a long time.
Yeah.
I spent time outside. But yes, what he means is spend a little more time in a meaningful way. I'll put it
in
a better way.
Let me interject to you. I meant I was not in college because I was pursuing my hobby, which is not a bad thing.
That's great, sir. We know that you have had a commerce degree. We'll get to the college education later. But before that, we want to know about the Dilip Chhabria before it could be the Dilip Chhabria. So starting with the school days, your childhood with your parents, I mean, how are you? What kind of, you were the naughty kind or the one who was completely tucked in your shirt, pull up your socks, go to school on time?
See, you know, if anybody knew me then, he would be shocked that I'm the same person. So what was I in school? I was an extremely shy young person, extremely shy. You know, painfully shy, I would say.
Okay.
I could not even make a telephone call. I was embarrassed to make a call. And infused with a lot of inferiority complex, maybe because I was shy. I'm maybe less shy today, but I still brag that I have a lot of inferiority complex. I think it's a great thing to have an inferiority complex. It's a great thing. So, hello. Yeah, so that was then. But I think because of the shyness and the complex that I had, I used the time for myself. I had solitude. And I think that was the genesis of my creativity. That was the genesis to further my passion. Rather than, you know, spend times going for movies, being with friends, going for parties, I used that time to empower myself. I think that's the lesson. Of course, I'm only talking to you from hindsight. But today I realized that why did I, if I was such a shy person and inbred with so much of a complex, how the hell did I succeed? But I think the genesis lay in the fact that it was these attributes that helped me be by myself. And I also remember reading an article in Time magazine a couple of years back. I'm sure it will be on the net and you can look it up. They have actually researched and they realize that most shy people tend to be somebody in their lives because they spend the time with themselves. So that's something should be good. So you guys, if you're shy, shout about it. You don't have to.
Giving time to yourself, what did you do? I mean, you said about being creative. Did you play with cars? Did you do something with design, drawing?
Yes, so, okay, I forgot to add that. I mean, I stopped short, but so I was always very much interested in cars. I remember seeing photographs of mine when I was a small boy and drawing cars and playing with toys. Also, I remember I used to, everywhere I could get a flat tablecloth or a napkin or a book, I would draw even on walls. My parents had to paint the apartments quite often because I would keep drawing and I would mimic the sounds of a car. So I was obsessively interested in cars. And so the hunger was there, and as I grew, I read about them, I surrounded myself with cars, and that's how I came to know a lot more stuff than I would have. And then, of course, I went to college, because one is expected to go to college, you're expected to be literate, be a graduate, be settled, be married, and I did all those things.
It's nice, sir. Back then in your school days, all of us have a role model. I want to become this. Did you have any role models as such?
Quite frankly, I never had any role model. I've been asked this question many times. And I never had any role models, not even film stars. I didn't watch Hindi movies much, but I never had any role models except just wanted to have good cars. And I would be surrounded with cars. I would take them to the service station every day to get them serviced, every day. Just okay. To, how do you while time with the car? But to be honest, I never had any role model then. I don't even have role models now, except in the field of design, I may have one or two. But that's
so rather than role models, you preferred car models.
Yes, that's like it.
Yes.
Absolutely, absolutely.
That's nice. Now, sir, moving a little forward, then you went to commerce school. Was it, you were so deeply interested in design, you did not take up engineering, you ended up in commerce. How did this happen?
See, because when you're passionate about design or cars, I didn't know the design was a career. I didn't know. I thought cars are made by engineers. I did not know that within the engineering realm, there is a field like design. I didn't know that. Because back in the late 70s, early 80s, India was a closed country. You never had periodicals, you never had magazines, you never had internet. So and you never had counseling. So I never knew that there's such an option as design. And obviously, when I was in college, as I admitted, I never went to college really. I would mug up the last few weeks, try to pass. And but I was terribly not interested in math. And therefore, I didn't pursue the field of engineering or science. Also, I didn't get good grades when I passed out of school. So for me, getting a graduation was not to further my career because I was expected to join my father's business. It was just to be stamped as a graduate for the to be suitable for a marriage association. That's about it.
And can I know what was the business that your father was?
Yeah. My father was manufacturing electronic components. He used to supply to companies at that time like Murphy and Philips and Nelco. He was into manufacturing components.
So running an organization is in your blood.
Yeah, I think being an entrepreneur, I think picked it up from my father because I had the building blocks. He ran it, so I had the people who I could, use some of the expertise to launch my own automotive accessories business. Because I don't know whether you guys know, but before I started DC Design in 1993, after I came back from the US, I went into automotive accessory business. Because that's where I could use my creativity and yet produce automotive accessories for Fiat and ambassadors, because there was no Maruti yet. And the Fiat and ambassadors were about 30 or 40 years old then. And imports were simply not allowed. And even if they were allowed, nobody in the world would make accessories for Fiat and ambassadors because the market was only India.
Okay.
So they did well and I became very successful. I had my own capital with which I could risk opening DC Design.
Sir, again, going to the college life, sure. Somebody you would like to remember. Madam, please close your ears.
Please close?
Or please close your ears. Somebody probably she doesn't want, or probably she already knows.
Of course, in fact, I had a girlfriend. I mean, why am I being applauded? Everybody has girlfriends, right? You're expected to have girlfriends. So it was. But
I think when somebody talks about it on stage, it's a license to them.
Well, I mean, but she actually reinforced the inferiority complex in me because she dumped me very fast. So I was convinced I had an inferiority complex. And today, believe me, I actually thank her because the insecurity that she gave me helped me achieve. So, guys, if you want to be successful, get dumped.
it's an honest admission. Honestly.
Guys and girls, sorry. I'm not trying to be sexist here, but... So, you know... so it's a very... I don't know how you asked me this question, but it's very... Since you asked me, I'd like to elaborate and let my hair down, whatever hair I've left. So... it's so interesting. Of course, she dumped me. She went her way, and I went her way. I went my way. And 25 years hence, in 1997, she called me out of the blue, and I knew it was her. I recognized her voice. 25 years hence, no touch, nothing. Because her son had become my fan. Okay. He was studying in Dune School. And that gave me such a power because I realized, okay, I was not so bad after all. of course, one thing led to the other, and her daughter became my daughter-in-law. So, ooh. You know. So, the moral of the story is very simple here. You can have all the power in the world if you bid for long term. If you forego short term, you're going to have the world coming to your door. Believe me. Because you have become rich and famous by then. But you can only become rich and famous if you allow yourself to succeed in the initial years. Hard work, no distractions.
Definitely. That's the thing that we need to take, guys. Okay, since you brought up this ratio about guys, girls. How many girls here? Yeah, in the afternoon we were talking about the ratio.
Yes.
And I said it is improving. Well, here's the proof.
Yes, of course.
And that's mechanical people, we understand.
But I think, you know, I might guess here, you are able to get a good crop of young men into your engineering college because there are enough girls in the campus. Am I right?
Is that right, people? Nice. Now, after commerce, then again, you decided that you had to go to US. You said that you did not have enough information that there is something called designing and you could go and do it in a college. How did you get this information?
So I had my father's friend who was in Air India. I don't know whether he was a pilot or he was a steward. And I used to, you know, cajole him to bring me some car magazines because I used to be hungry. And then and now there's a magazine called Car and Driver. And there was an ad about one college and it extolled it. Do you want to be a car designer? And I said, yeah, of course, I would love to be a car designer. And I wrote to them. And I got a prospectus, and I was very excited that I could actually, have a career. And so that's how I went to the US, got myself trained, educated, and of course I came back. That's another story. But so I came to know because I got hold of this magazine from him, and that was the first time I got to know that there's something like a college for car design.
Thanks to the ad maker here.
Yeah, absolutely.
No, had he not made the ad, probably we wouldn't have had the DC that we have today.
No, I'm sure you would have some other guys, I'm sure, but...
Being modest. Right. So then, sir, you came to know about this. Then you fly to US. Now let's all fly to US. How was your life in US? Commerce to engineering, something related to design and...
Yeah, so the commerce was of no use, and I just admitted that I was a very shy person. So I was not the one who could let his hair down or enjoy the freedom and the life of the United States. So I was terribly homesick. I didn't like being there. However, I had to complete that. And so being a commerce student didn't help me. I was happy that I was surrounded with cars. I was happy that I visit factories, design centers, and all that. But I think deep down, I was a very reserved person. So I was not somebody who would be out in the ranks, in the front ranks.
Okay.
And that's one of the reasons I think why I came back, because I wanted to be in India, because I felt comfortable being in India.
Okay.
But when you were there, you were into cars, you had a different education system altogether.
Yes.
How was the change? What was the difference, the Indian education system compared with the US system back then?
See, US education system afforded that freedom to you. It was based on the credit system, so you could do a lot of other things. It allowed you to explore. It gave you the resources. It gave you the environment. But beyond that, even there, you have to really dig your own heels and you know, empower yourself with the knowledge that you want to do, what you want to pursue. I thought I would join a large company and you know, work there as a designer, as 99% of the people do. I did not know that having joined such a large company, I would feel very lost. I would feel like a statistic. Such a bureaucratic organization. They had then about 1,500 designers. And more importantly, I felt that to really do a whole car of what I wanted to do, and that's why I went, it would have taken me 25, 30 years to attain seniority, and then only they would give me the project. And I said, I'm not being happy being in the US, and to wait there for 25 years to be a car, to be given a car project, I was not willing to wait. Therefore, I came back very fast.
So, sir, before we come back to India,
sure.
Anybody there that you would like to acknowledge? Somebody who really, you said you were a shy person, you had homesickness, somebody who helped you.
Yeah, of course. One of our teachers was Chuck Jordan, who had just, in fact, he was a chair at that time. He was also heading General Motors Design. There was Tom Peters, who was studying with me. So, I mean, you have these 3-4 faculty members who really kind of bring out the best in me, would cajole me and all that. But as I said, you can't even imagine how shy I was. So, you know, just keep to myself and felt really lost in a big country. I was not somebody who made friends very easily. In fact, even as I talk to you, I don't have friends. And I ascribe one of the reasons of my success of not having friends.
Okay.
Because I use that time to myself.
Okay. One more question about your parents, sir. You wanted to change the line. Usually, as you said, they wanted a degree. They wanted you to get on with your father's business.
Yes, yes.
What was their acceptance level when you said you wanted to change the line, go abroad?
See, they indulged me because I was maybe the only male member in the family, and my parents were affluent, so they could probably afford that education. So they wanted me to try out. Of course, they were very concerned whether I would be able to manage with all the shyness. So my father sent me not because he expected me to really be a designer as a profession. He sent me because I wanted to go. I mean, I think I relentlessly pursued him, and he let me go. But so they were encouraging to me. He realized that I had no heart in his electronics business. I used to go after I graduated from HR College in Commerce. I used to go every morning, and I used to dream up of an excuse of wanting to go here, wanting to go there, just to get out of office, because I didn't understand what is a frequency and what is an ohm and all that. It simply didn't interest me. So I think I had my father who encouraged me. Fortunately, he could afford it. My father was also a trailblazer. In the sense, he followed a unique profession himself. So I think he was a maverick in his community. He was also educated in the US. In our community at that time, in his age, it was almost a rare thing. I think he believed in the pursuit of individualism. He believed in the pursuit of happiness for the sake of happiness and not just economics. I think those are the building blocks.
Round of applause for his parents, people. Yeah. Thank you. US is done. Let's come back to India.
Yeah.
When you were coming back to India, did you have the idea of being an entrepreneur on your way back, or was it a decision made after you came back?
No, I was expected to follow my father's business in his footsteps. In the absence of any direction, I was expected to go with him to office every day. In fact, I did almost 2 years. I ran an electronics factory with him, and I was very, very miserable. I used to go late because I wanted to be less there, and okay. I would have a war with my father every morning and try to leave half an hour earlier, go half an hour late. So I did that for 2 years. I was expected to be an entrepreneur. I was not expected to be an automotive entrepreneur. That was for sure.
Okay.
Yeah, because I did this. I ran my father's factory before I went to the US, after my graduation from HR, because I didn't know that I could become a car designer.
So when did this idea of becoming a car designer or an entrepreneur in this field strike you?
No, so when I came back from the US, see, why I came back from the US, I realized that I'm not going to stay with General Motors for 25 years, because I'm not going to be pushed around and ordered to do this. Basically, my job would have been to design a hubcap or a door handle. It would never have been a full car till I attained 25, 30 years of seniority,
yes,
because you probably know, all of you know, that it takes billions of dollars to put a car on the road, and they are not going to give that power to some young lad from India who is not proven himself and the ability to design a car. That was not going to come. I realized then. I didn't know all that when I joined college. You know, you tend to be idealistic and you don't have enough knowledge of how it works. So, but when I came back, what do I do with my passion for cars, and what do I do with my knowledge and education? So I had to do something with cars, and I requested my father, give me a small section of the factory, give me about 3 people. And I want to develop some car accessories. And he allowed it. And that, because I had that talent, I had that education, and because the Fiat's and ambassadors didn't have contemporary accessories, and mine were contemporary because I redesigned them, they did very, very well in the market. In fact, I remember when I just got married, and my father, I used to make enough money every 2 months that I could buy a flat in South Bombay, which my father never made. So he kind of was shocked at this ability. I remember the first accessory was a horn pad for a steering wheel for a Fiat Padmini at that time. It cost me 8 rupees, and I used to sell it for 45 rupees. And I was laughing my way to the bank, because I had lines of people across India. We had orders. So my father then said, okay, I'm giving the whole factory to you, because it seems you have talent and you grow it. And that's how the journey started of accessories, which was so crucial in understanding materials and processes, which was to become my strength in car design.
Okay, that is... And what was your first job, sir? The first job, nobody can forget the first job with the accessories. The first job, was it the horn?
Horn pad.
The horn pad was the first job.
It was a horn pad for the Fiat car.
When you started off this, how many people were you together? In the company, some portion was given to you. You had a team of?
As I said, when I started it, my father had just given me 3 people. And to assemble, I had employed some 5-6 people more. So it was about 8-9 people. This was, I think, in 77.
77.
Yeah.
All right. 77 people. How many years since then?
30.
30, 40? What is it?
I think
39, nearly 40 years.
Yeah.
So ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, it's been nearly 40 years since the first job came to him. And after that, a lot of things happened. We got lots of designs. You saw many designs. A Bond car was designed. And an Indian supercar was made. A yacht was modified. A helicopter was modified. All this was done in this 40 years. Let's talk about all of this in more in detail with the one and only Dilip Chhabria, but after a short break. Please don't go anywhere. Stay here. We have a short break for 10 minutes. Welcome back to the session, Mr. Chhabria.
Welcome. Thank you.
Well, sir, this part we thought we would make some questions with the career and profession part of it.
Sure.
But before that, something that probably relates to your career and your personal life. We all know that you're very creative. We have seen your designs. We know the level of creativity. And you have certainly proved it in your personal life also.
Thank you for the backhanded compliment.
Any idea why I'm talking this? The two names of a son and daughter.
Yeah. Okay.
Minika and Bonito.
Yeah.
How did this name strike, sir? Any history for this?
You know, I and my wife, when we were expecting the children, we opened the world book. There was a compendium of world cars. And we would go down phonetically through the list, whichever sounded good, we named them. Of course, today, they're very angry because one was a kid car, Bonito was a kid car.
Yes.
But it sounded unique and good. And so, you know, that shows the level of obsession that I had for cars. And of course, we abbreviate his name and we call him Bonnie. But yeah, that's a fact. I mean, both were named after cars. Yeah.
After the cars. And I also understand, I was curious, I went through the net to know what is Minika. And I came to know, surprisingly, that there are only 28 people in the world who have this name.
Oh, is it?
Yes. Oh, new fact for you also, right?
Yes, absolutely.
People. I just went through, and there are only 28 people, so this makes even more special.
Yeah, I would think so. I didn't know that. Yeah. Though it's a very, you know, it's a very feminine sounding name and it doesn't sound very unique like Bonito does. It doesn't sound. In fact, many, many times we get letters on our behalf saying Meneka.
Okay.
You know, so, but I'm quite surprised that only 28 such people, but good for her, I guess. And it's my son is more flabbergasted at how could we even dream of such a name for him. But
okay.
I mean, that's said and done, and he can't do anything about it.
And I understand that currently they are helping you out with this business.
My son looks after the marketing setup in Delhi. We have a unit in Delhi, and my daughter handles Mumbai. My son is he gets in all the money.
Okay.
And he's also got almost an official title of the chief spending officer.
Okay. So we know how DC Designs gets big numbers.
Yeah, I mean, he carries forward the same passion, the same knowledge, but he doesn't carry forward the same insecurities that I go. If I were to, let's say, go to a customer, let's say I went to Shah Rukh Khan, and I would come across as very needy, want the job. And my son will show him and simply not answer his calls.
Okay.
So he'll make him insecure.
Okay.
And that's how it works, unfortunately. And it works, yeah.
All right, sir. You came back, you started off. How was the journey through these years to start off as a new entrepreneur?
Yep.
In a new field which was just upcoming in India, and then taking up a big job with the Fiat. Back then, of course, Fiat was and Premier, they were the premier cars of India. And then the journey of these years.
Yeah. See, the accessory business was pretty much set, because you were selling to the market that existed. So maybe Kashmiri Gate in Delhi and Opera House in Bombay. So there were dealers who would trade in accessories. So you would manufacture, it was unique. You would give it to them, they would sell it, and you know, so it was pretty much just like any other manufacturing unit. That was a very stable business. I went home at 5:30. I took my kids to club. And that was it. But then as I became successful in that, the restlessness in me was always there to design a whole car. I was then making accessories which are parts of the cars. So passion was ever present. So I started DC Design in 1993. If you saw my vision statement, the essence was that if I could create an organization that could give these design services to Indian OEMs or foreign OEMs, which was the target at that point of time, but at Indian cost in Indian time, how could it fail? More so when also we were able to create differentiated designs. I had the conviction then, and this is a very important fact that all of you must imbibe. You have to have the conviction in what you're doing. I had the conviction that each one of us individuals are encoded to expect change. You want something new every day of your life.
Definitely.
So I realized if that is omnipresent in every human being, and if I could deliver that in the automotive sphere, it would survive. The company would survive. And I also had the advantage of designing from India at much low cost, 1/5, 1/10 the cost. Initially also the impetus was, because I was successful in the accessory business, I had my own, cars, and I thought, okay, at least I'll be able to maintain my own cars in my own unit. So those are the reasons I started, and the conviction was there. I was very fortunate that my work spoke loudly, and I had a contract from Mahindra and Mahindra in the first 6 months of opening. They locked me down for the first 2 years. The Armada was designed by me, the Commander was designed by me, and then we never looked back, because the word spreads around within the circles, within the industry, that there is this new kid on the block and he's great, and and I drove my own cars that I customized. So, and because car is such a dynamic object, it goes from point A to point B. If I would park it at a restaurant, people would gather around it, and you know, they would tuck in visiting cards, wanting to find out how I got this car. So I kind of became popular very early, much earlier. In fact, today also, people are quite surprised that we are 23 years old. They thought it's a much older organization. And most of the success we got in the initial 2-3 years when we were just 2-3 years old. So people didn't, I mean, because we were helped, but the car is a moving object. So it helps you, it's like a moving billboard.
That is a nice journey, sir. Yeah. But was there a point which you could call a breakthrough? Or was it a linear graph?
No, there have been milestones which would be considered breakthrough in the sense they put us into a different level by far. So it has been linear largely. And one of the reasons has been that when I followed the Italian design houses, I realized that they tend to be cyclical. They follow the boom and bust cycle because they're dependent on car manufacturers. So if the manufacturer doesn't have a program, they go bust.
Okay.
And I realized I can't be in that situation. So I very consciously realized that I have to have the end consumer in my target audience also. That is why the customizing business was very important. And it is a customizing business which gave us a brand. It is the customizing business which gave us the visibility from a media perspective, because that was something unique. So, because I followed these aspects, it was never a situation where my revenue would fluctuate. It was always growth. But within that, there have been milestones every couple of years that put us into a next level by far, for sure.
And sir, we have seen many designs of yours.
Right.
What inspires you to get the designs? For example, for some artists, they look at the nature around and they get inspired and they come up with something new. And we have seen circumstances where some designers have told, this has been evolved from the nature. Is it something like that or something else?
No, I mean, you're right. I mean, that's what some of the designers have commented. and I'm asked this question every single day of my life. And an honest answer is that nature doesn't inspire me. What inspires me is, how do I get ideas? See, it's all about going back in time sometimes. You have to raid some of the past designs, but you have to fuse it with future future trends. But importantly, I think it's a very simple process of getting inspired, of creating a design. I know most of you struggle to even understand how the hell do you get that line or that form. But it's all about being knowledgeable about what somebody is doing in their design rooms or design studios 5 years hence, 10 years hence. You extrapolate those with the past. Okay, that design, if somebody did in 1920, what was the outcome? So you have to be totally learned in the profession. You cannot be superfluous. You have to have the mastery and the depth of the subject beyond reproach. And once you realize that information is there for you, because information is power, then you try to differentiate. Because design is all about being differentiated. Design is all about in the future. Now that dictates your design. How do you want to differentiate? So you'll draw a curve different from what somebody's done. And it has to be into the future. So there you have the inspiration.
That's great, sir. That is something that we all have to learn. Yeah. Get deep in the knowledge.
It's
know
not
what
very
you're
difficult.
Doing.
Once you enter the game, believe me, it comes automatically. Yes. It's not difficult.
Right, sir. And let's get to some of the products that you have done.
Sure.
We have been curious about the Bond car. How was the experience with Hollywood?
We never worked with the film directly. We worked with the Aston Martin company. So we had this breakthrough in 2003 where we were asked to develop this car. It was a very, very big day in our life in Indian history. In fact, I remember I was on air live across all the business channels in India, CNBC, NDTV, and all that. And we were the subject of editorial comment in most mainstream print newspapers like Economic Times, Times of India, because the editors felt that is a way for India to go forward, you know, IPR, and not just being back-end mastery of manufacturing like China. So why was that? Because it was a huge day for India that you not only won this job from the global competitors, but you won it from Aston Martin. And you can't get higher than an Aston Martin for your breakthrough job. It was the first job internationally. That was in 2003. The whole company was set up in 1993 to actually offer these services. It took us 10 years. But we were very lucky that we didn't get into some low-end commuter car as a breakthrough. We got the Aston Martins. That I was very fortunate. Thank you.
The applause says it all. We are all proud of it, sir.
Thank you. So and they used it in the movie because I think Astons have been regularly used in the movie. We were very fortunate that that was a car done by us. And the media had already carried reports, as I said, in India about the Aston Martin being debuted at the Detroit Motor Show in 2003. I think the movie came in 2004, I think, 2003 or 4. So Indian media already had carried the story of we having done the project. So they just put two and two together, and some of the magazines or print media carried the fact that we had done it for the movie. And it helped us, so we didn't contest that. It's as simple as that.
So, the next project, an important one for India.
Yeah.
The Avanti.
Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, we all know that it is considered as the supercar of India. Yeah. But I'm curious about the name once again. Why the name Avanti?
Again, see, we are an aesthetic family. We give a lot of credence to right sounding names or right sounding shapes. And the car was supposed to be, the concept car was, had to debut at the Delhi Motor Show in 2012. Mr. Amitabh Bachchan unveiled the car. And the car till such time was called the Budh because the Budh circuit had come online. 2011 was the first race. Just 4 days before the Auto Expo was to start, and we had printed those press kits and all that, I was down with dengue in the hospital. I had a lot of time to myself. And I realized that, you know, it's a very godly name, Budh. It's unfit for a macho sports car, hot car, you know. So I told my son, this name doesn't sound well. And so he dreamt up this name Avanti, because important was that it had to again phonetically sound right. It also had to sound Indian as well as Italianesque as well as feminine. So we just had to dream up this name in just about a day's time, because we had to make new press kits. And that is the story of Avanti.
That so was no quite creative.
Research, there's no research behind that.
Imaginative. Again, some curiosity in me, why this feminine name?
We refer to cars as feminine, no? Every desirable product is a feminine product. Remember that.
Yes, sir. Now, coming to about the designing industry in India, have there been major competitors for you in this? Because most of us have heard of only DC Designs.
Yeah.
And apart from this, did you ever feel anybody to be a competitor for you?
You know, I wish there were competitors, because it would grow our industry faster. But there is none. And I'm trying to figure out, because I'm asked again this question every time because it seems like an anomaly. Because no walk of life, you have a situation where for so many years you're unchallenged. And the answer lies in the fact that, you know, we built a brand when there was no one around, people left us alone. We went from strength to strength, so you coalesce that brand. Plus, not everybody wants to sacrifice a great career. I mean, I'm sure there were many designers who went to the US. They would be, recruited by the top brands and they are happy because I don't think any designer wants to be an entrepreneur. He doesn't want to swim in the, shark, waters, because it's a lot of trouble, a lot of hassles. So that's a sacrifice that not many have made. I made that. So that's one factor, I think, why there is no competition. There will be many wannabes. There will be many amateurs. But it shows in their work that, they don't have the depth, they don't have the domain knowledge. And I don't think anybody is going to give, if you have a car, you're not going to go to somebody who doesn't have a brand, who has not proven himself, because you are giving him an asset. Just because it's 20, 30%, 50% cheaper, the chances are he'll destroy your asset. So I think because of that nature, also, in the initial years, you get a credibility, you get a great word of mouth, and I think you build on that strength. Why there is no competition? The other aspect is also that, if you saw my presentation, we behave as if we have competition. We behave, we are a paranoid organization. We behaved, okay, somebody's going to eat our lunch tomorrow. There may be nobody, but we have levitated the whole organization in a manner as if there's huge competition. So we don't behave arrogant. We don't rest on our laurels. We are obsoleting ourselves every day. These are things you do because of competition. We don't have competition, but we are doing it. So that has set us so far apart that if the competition has to emerge, even if they put 500 crores, it's still going to take them 10, 20 years to build that credibility. That's the reason.
And sir, you mentioned about the newcomers not having the domain knowledge or the depth of knowledge in this.
Yeah.
Do you think, is it something, some fault with respect to the generation, or is it some fault with respect to the education system? What could be this?
No, I think it's not the... it's
or the exposure.
See, the education system is one aspect where you turn out these youngsters, but they don't have the physicality and the experience of that, because there's a big gap between what they learn and what the job demands, unless they are in it for 5-10 years. The other aspect is that it's not easy to be an entrepreneur in India. So it's now easier, but still, till such time, it's not been very easy to be an entrepreneur for a product company in India. And because of design, nature of design, it's usually never measurable. You can't measure design, the success of design in monetary terms. So it's a mumbo-jumbo science. And all this, probably, they are not able to have the confidence to demonstrate to the customers that they have all that. I believe we succeeded because I started late. I was 38 years old, so I had the experience of materials and processes. Also, by that time, I was an entrepreneur, but I was hungry for knowledge. And I mentioned in my opening presentation that I had to embrace love for finance. I had to embrace love for marketing. Though I'm a creative guy, but I had to love it. I didn't have to use or didn't have to learn finance because I had to do as a job. I had to look at the numbers and excite myself. So you have to build that intensity. And that, I think, builds an all-round capability around the company, which is very difficult for others to pierce through, I think. I think that's important, yeah.
So we all know that your designs are unique and have a class of its own.
Thank you.
But we also know they are expensive.
Yes.
Is there something on your mind that you can get for the common man? Most of us must have read this in an interview of his. You said that I cannot afford my own designs.
Yes, that's true. That's true. So absolutely true. Nobody believes me. So So what am I aspiring for? And what I want all of you to aspire for? Why do you want me to come down to your level? Why don't you rise to my level? I'm telling myself that I need to earn more to be able to drive my own car. No, but that was in a lighter vein. I think the important thing is when you're designing, the number of man-hours that go into creating a unique car is stupendous. 25,000-30,000 man-hours for one car. Avanti has taken 1.6 million man-hours to develop. So now, you know, we have invested in the program, so the cost per unit is lower. So this makes it very expensive. Now, let me tell you the other dimension. No concept car in the world is less than 35-40 crores. We do it for manufacturers at 1/5 the price. I'll give you another dimension. Nowhere in the world can the customer have that power that he can have one unique car in the world. Okay, he's paying a crore, or he's paying 50 lakhs, I don't know, whatever it is. But he's the power to have one car in the world. An American or a German would love to be in his shoes with that kind of pricing. So it depends on how you look at it, glass half full or glass half empty.
Do you have any plans in the future to probably against what you said, Nav, to reduce the price, get some designs for the so-called common man?
See, I don't think our business model will allow that because we are a private company. We don't have public money. And I don't want public money because I want my freedom. So our positioning, as I mentioned, is something that a manufacturer will not or cannot do. What is that he will not do? He will not create a niche because it's too small a volume for him. We want to be there because our margins tend to be about 30-40%. Manufacturers, when they make a car, is 9-10%. Now, why would I want to do a business of 9-10% when I can walk myself to the bank with 30-40% and exclusivity? I don't have to discount my cars. So, you know, in fact, getting into a cheaper car would hurt our brand. So, and the business model doesn't allow it. We are a differentiated business model. That's a place under the sun. And we are very happy doing that because even that niche, if we follow through our plans, is a huge niche. If you total it up, it can be close to 20,000-30,000 cars, which is huge for us.
And what do you see as the future of the automobile industry in India, probably in the next 10-15 years?
Okay, my guess is that when we talk about in India, according to me, everything in the world is similar now. There's no such thing as India or, you know, except of course the penetration of car ownership is much higher. But the usage patterns and the choice of cars or the product, a car is a global animal. Cars are not designed for a market because it's simply not possible. But having said that, globally, with the shared economy now upon us, even in India, I expect the car as a commuter to cease. Cars will not be used for commuting from point A to point B. I'm talking of, let's say, 10 to 15 years horizon. So you will have cars which people are going to use for leisure or adventure. Cars are going to be there. You can't wish it away because it's a very emotional and a very passionate product for acquisition. It's a status symbol. So cars will be there for that reason, but they will be in the leisure and adventure space.
What is the segment that you see the maximum growth? Probably diesel cars, petrol cars, hybrid cars, electric?
See, the IC car, IC engine car, we've already seen with the government clampdown on diesel cars and the emission norms, it is going to be increasingly petrol cars coming back to rule. However, I think because of the emission problems across the world, the electric car is going to gain strength, though it's not viable. Electric car is going to gain strength. The government is going to subsidize the viability in a big way. China is a big proponent of the electric car now. They are the world's largest producer of electric cars now. And the government is giving huge grants to companies to produce electric cars because of the CO2 norms. So I see electric car gaining momentum, but it will still be about 20-30% of the market size. Largely, it will be the petrol engine which is going to claw back, and diesels are going to keep coming down. They have already started coming down. I think 10 years from now, you will have just maybe few percentage, 5-10% as diesels. Maybe 15-20% electrics, and the rest will be petrol.
Is it because of the prices of the fuel?
No.
Or
no.
Is it something?
No, it's because of the emissions.
Emission.
Obviously. Because of the emissions that diesel engines are not able to... Diesel engines are not able to fulfill those norms.
Okay, so now you have designed many things. You have designed cars, and I also understand that you have designed yachts.
No, we have not designed yachts yet.
Not designed?
No, we want to get into yachts.
Okay.
But India doesn't have a maritime history, so it's difficult to really, you know, dock a yacht.
Okay.
We're working on that, but not yet.
Okay.
We have designed planes, choppers.
Choppers, yeah. Yes. Yeah. Is there something that you really want to design but you have not been able to get your hands on?
You see, we want to, there are two aspects. One is the manufacturing arm of the company that, like the Avanti, that's for the growth. The other is the design part of the company where we want to get into all sorts of activities to own the design space, be it houses, be it offices, be it yachts, be it industrial products. So there's a distinct differentiation. We want to grow, because design is something that if you have mastered design in the automotive space, that is the mother load of all industries. So if you have mastered automotive design, you can just about design anything else, but not vice versa. So having gained a credibility in the automotive space, we are desirous of getting a whole development cell going after the other industries. In fact, we've just designed fans for a leading fan manufacturer, and you'll see it on television shortly. So there's a lot of scope for such interventions, not necessarily just cars.
With so many designs in place, anything that is... I understand that you love all the designs that you have made. Anything that is really close to the heart.
I may not love all the designs.
Okay.
Because at least 20% of the designs we haven't shown you because they're disastrous and ghastly.
So anything that is very close to your heart, your favorite?
Yeah, the favorite is always the last one. Because because you're in that trance. Is like a love affair. Your favorite is the latest girlfriend that you have. It's as simple as that. Till my next one comes along.
Yeah, till the next one comes along.
Yeah.
It's nice. So your word of advice for these people here, there are a lot of people who are aspiring to be designers.
Yeah.
They want to take up a career in designing, and as we discussed earlier, they would like to venture into different things. Some people into designing, as we said, about the combustion engines, then electric engines, or something.
Yeah.
So what is your word of advice? What should they do? I hope they don't make competitors for you later on.
I would love it if they can be not, I wouldn't see them as competitors. I would see them collectively creating India as a space where original design is done in a mainstream way. I would see them that way. I would love that they are competitors because it will help us go even higher. Because as I said, we are a paranoid organization. When we don't have competition, we are on the edge. If we have competition, we'll definitely be on the edge much more. We welcome that. But the word of advice is, you know, I've been telling you guys in the afternoon that there's no better time than now to be young in India. The government is enabling a lot of initiatives, Make in India, Skill India, Digital India, Design India. Use that, because my experience is that design is one field which is about future. And only future can create curiosity. And if you're able to produce or deliver on somebody's curiosity, that's money in the bank. But that's the only aspect, that aspect only design can cater to you. Now, whether they have the liking or not, but I think personally, I would assume that, you know, eschew short-term gains to build a durable long-term career for yourself. You know, so you can't have, there are going to be trade-offs. If you want short-term bank balances, forget it. You're in long-term, you're going to be a statistic. You're going to be burnt out. You're going to be a commodity. But if you want to be somebody who's known, you have to forget short-term. You have to build your strengths. You have to prove it day in, day out, year in, year out. So do something that you love doing. Your love is not going to come because you're born with it. You're not born with anything. You have to pick up what you love, work on it, embrace it, concentrate. You have to start loving it. Once you start loving it, once you pass that stage, you will excel in a big, big way. That's a word of advice. Follow your dreams.
Well, sir, you spoke of curiosity.
Yeah.
And there are a lot of curious people here.
Sure.
Some things picked up, some questions that the team of Think Tank deems
right
to be asked here at this forum.
Sure.
At first, Shirley, she wants to know, I am not sure about what my passion is, what should I do?
Okay, so you're not sure about your passion. If you can identify, I need to put a face to that question. Yeah.
Can we have Shirley, seat number, ticket number 1515. Can we have the lights on the audience side?
Oh, maybe he's given the question and gone. Okay. Okay, so you're not sure about what you want to do. I can understand. But are you sure that you want to have a good standard of living or not? You want to be poor or you want to be rich? So you want to be successful or you want to be you want to be faceless? Once you answer those questions, that will give you the answer of what you should do. And then, of course, you deploy that passion into that, what you should do. So that's something, as I said, I keep saying again and again, you have to have great knowledge about everything around you, not just engineering. You have to have great knowledge of what works in the finance world, what works in the marketing world, and that you will get the answer. I mean, you have to create passion. As I keep saying, or no actor or no artist is ever born. He's made. But you must know what you want to do. And to know what you want to do, it will come through if you don't have passion. I mean, if you don't have that interest. Most of us, by the time we are in our teens, we know what appeals to us. But if he's still in a situation where he does not know what appeals to us, then he has to follow the other aspects. He has to follow the other building blocks. What will make him rich?
Shirley, I believe you have got the answer. Yes.
Okay.
Let's go to the next question. Sharon Kumar wants to know, what was the toughest you ever made in your design career?
Yeah. Well, there have been a couple of projects, but the toughest one was the Ambi rod that I showed you, which was inspired from the ambassador. Because I couldn't have lost the DNA and the continuity of the car, yet I had to showcase progress 20, 30 years hence. Now, how do I do something which they have not kept evolving for the last 40 years? So that was tough, to make every surface or every line look contemporary and futuristic, yet not shedding the past DNA. So that was the toughest job so far.
Laksh Verma wants to know, what would be the biggest obstacle, according to you, in your design career? That is what the question means, I suppose. Is Laksh here? Ticket number 156. Yeah, Laksh, this is what you wanted to know.
The right? Biggest obstacle. Will the biggest obstacle is going to come, or what has been the biggest obstacle? Time. Lack of time. Not money. Because time gone by, you're not going to get it back. Money you lose, you'll get it back. But I think I would think time is the biggest obstacle to use. How can I get more time out of the 24 hours? But if you're talking, if you want to really know from a tangible point of view, I think the biggest obstacle has been, how do I get all my people, 700 of them, to work as hard as me, 18 hours a day? I can forego my work-life balance because I own the company and the company is named after me, so I have the glory. How do I make them do it? And that's been, I've succeeded by far, but I think those are the things. I don't think money has been an obstacle. I don't think getting people has been an obstacle. I don't think getting customers has been an obstacle. Because I personally believe that you build a better mousetrap, and the world will come to your door. Believe me, if you do something great, if you're doing it with your passion, undistilled passion, you will have money chasing you. You will have disdain for money. Believe me.
So at this point, you said about time, 18 hours a day.
Yeah.
And the lady is here.
Yeah.
How tough has it been for her?
Remember, I started late. I started at 38. So I gave her the time in the initial years. I brought up the children when they were 13, 14 years. I gave them that on the constructive years. I gave them the time. And to be very honest, after that they didn't need us because they were embarrassed to be with us. So it suited me, suited them, and she didn't know which way to go. So I guess she stuck around with me because maybe I'm a decent human being for her.
It's nicer. And looking back at the company and your life from today, is there anything you regret doing or not doing? Or anything you would like to change?
Yeah, I think, though it has held me in good stead, being insecure and as I said, shy and all that. But I think it has also made me a little pessimist. And I would like to be an optimist. I would like to have an attitude of, you know, seeing the glass full. That's something that I think I would want to have it. If I could change my habit, I don't know whether I can. But that's something that worries me. I have a lot of worries when I go to sleep. And who wants to be sleepless? So that's something I would love to change.
Johan. Is Johan here? Ticket number 250. Oh yes, he was the one who asked the question.
Yeah.
All right, moving on. Which aspect of the automobile industry appeals you the most besides design?
Besides design. I think, as I said, product planning, which comes under the marketing department. You have to know which product a customer will desire 5 or 10 years from now. And that's very difficult to predict. You know, a good designer is measured by 25 years, because let's say the car is on the drawing board from 1 to 5 years. At the end of 5th year, it's launched in the market. It will be there for the next 7 years. So from the time of sketch, it is 12 years. And it's going to be used for the next 7 to 10 years. Now, if that design is still contemporary at the end of his life cycle, that person is a great designer. So that is only possible when you have a very strong ability to presage or imagine the segments or the car that the customer is going to need 5, 10, 15 years hence. Now that is very exciting to do crystal ball gazing in for future 10, 15 years. Sounds very daunting, but once you're at it, it's fantastic. It's very exciting.
All right. Going to the next question, sir. Can we expect an automated car from DC?
Yes, of course. Of course, we're working on that already. Yeah.
All right.
Thank you. I mean, though we are a small company, our dreams are never small. For example, the Avanti is already Euro 5 compliant when there was not even Euro 5 requirement in India. You know, people really are very curious. All the biggies, in fact, call me up and ask me, and when we meet them at the different fora, and they asked me how, as a startup, from a sketch to a reality, you went in 33 months, you produced a car when we struggled. My car is a can-based car. So what does it mean? That when we start off, we want the best. We don't have the resources, believe me. But we make it happen. I personally believe, and this is a very important advice I'm giving you, the mind is such a powerful tool. You'll be shocked. But the point is, you must want it badly enough. You will make your road. Believe me, you will have to make your road. If you think, oh, it's not going to be possible, it costs too much, how can I do it? Nothing is going to happen. You have to put yourself out there. Put yourself with your back to the wall. I'm really telling you, put yourself with the back to the wall. The genetic encodement of survival will take over. You will survive having put your back to the wall, but you will also achieve.
Thank you for the word of advice.
You know, I don't want to be disparaging to the MBAs of the world. I would never employ an MBA because they have so many choices. They have that, you know, because they are not in a position of putting their back to the wall. I'm sorry, I'm not trying to be disparaging, yeah, but you know, the point is, put yourself in a situation where you have no choice but to succeed.
Thank you, sir. It's an interesting question. Why does DC Design charge a lot for the matte paint?
Matte paint.
Pavan, ticket number 364.
Yeah.
Okay, he wants to know.
Okay, we charge a lot for the matte paint because we don't want to paint matte. So it's a kind of a, we don't want to say we don't want to paint your car. So what do you do if you don't want to really advise him to paint a matte car? We charge a bomb so that he doesn't paint a car, but yet some people do it. The other aspect is it's leveraged on the price points of some of the cars that offer this. And the customers who come to us are the elite. So if a Ferrari matte paint job costs you 25 lakhs, we believe we can charge 10 lakhs or 9 lakhs. But I don't personally believe that the matte paint is going to work in the long term, because in 6 to 8 months' time, it shows up in a very bad way. So we kind of, discourage. And that's one of the reasons why it's priced that way. Also not to make it too common for everyone to do it.
Yes, sir. Going next up. Was there ever a point where you had to deal with failure? How did you balance it? Which you felt as to be a failure?
I still don't consider myself a success. So I know you might think I'm acting. But the moment I consider myself a success, I would start failing. So as I said, the organization and me, we are paranoid. What are we paranoid about? That if we fail, the craft that I love, it will be taken away from me. So because of that sensitivity towards that, we are always on our toes. But you know, just can you paraphrase that question again? I've lost my train. What
was there ever a point where you had to deal with failure? How did you balance back?
Yeah, so failure, we have dealt with failure in the past when we were ahead of times. We had a unit in Silvassa where we were making car kits and we invested a lot of money and there simply wasn't any market. So you have to dig your heels, you have to survive, you have to work harder. Failure is part of success, you know. Failure is the stepping stone to success, for sure. If you didn't fail, probably you would not succeed in a bigger way. In the US, if you are a failure, you actually can go to the bank and cite it as one of the strong points of you wanting to succeed.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's nice.
So failure is a stepping stone to success because there's so much learning why you fail. You introspect and you actually ensure that you don't do it again. And it also makes you humbler. Because you've gone there, you've done that, you failed, you realize you're not God. And it makes you a better entrepreneur. You endear yourself to other people. Makes you far. I think those are the building blocks for trying to get success then.
Definitely, sir. We also believe that is why we have makeup exams.
You have what exams?
If a student fails in a particular subject, we have a makeup examination.
Yeah.
And this is treated as the original examination. It's not reflected in the marks card.
Yeah, sure. But I think the point is, he should be bragging about his failure then, not hiding away from it. Failure is a good word.
Yes. So next, what's more important, class or performance?
Both. You can't have class without performance. And you can't have performance without class. You can have performance without class, but the business that we are in, products have to be classy, otherwise why would somebody come to us? Nobody's going to come to us for performance. At DC Design, we don't even care whether the car has an engine or not. We are not in that stream. We are not in a situation of jack of all trades and master of none. We are in the design business. We are in the body made business of exterior and interior design. We don't care if the car is an engine. So for us, performance of the vehicle dynamics doesn't interest us.
Right, sir. When I spoke of the class, something again struck me, which I should have asked before.
Right.
DYPDC.
Yeah.
How did the idea strike? When did it begin?
It began in 2010. See, I started becoming a role model for these youngsters who were car crazy, and they all wanted to become car designers. And the parents would come to me for guidance. And I would tell them, go to United States, go to Germany, go to England. But there came a time in around 2009-10 when I realized that the industry would need these youngsters and they would have serious job career options in India. At that time, there was no other institute able to incept with that credibility. And I realized that I needed to do that. We also were growing. I also wanted raw material for my growth. So it was a win-win situation and that's how the idea was born. But it was born because the automobile draft policy as laid out in 2006 projected a huge shortfall of automotive designers. It is still projecting a huge shortfall of automotive designers because remember, cars are selling because you're able to create new models and the frequency is coming down. So you've got to develop newer models faster, more variants. So there's going to be a huge demand for designers. So the institutes have to be there to cater to them.
For people who do not, anybody who doesn't know what is DYPDC? Well, yes, Okay, that is an institution that is run by DC. DYPDC is an institution for designers. So can you a little elaborate about the curriculum, what we do at DYPDC?
Yeah, so this is in partnership with the DY Patil Group, who bring in infrastructure on the table and their university status on the table, and we provide the curriculum and we provide the faculty and we provide the vocational experience. But it's a very unique college in the world where the student, when he's learning, he also comes and creates a car physically. So it's aligned to that. So it's a very, very unique course. We could do it because of the company that we had. And we have had a very good success rate of absorption because, I mean, the first 2-3 years, we had to prove our credibility. But as of now, I think the word in the market is that our students have the depth. I mentor them once in 3 months, once in 4 months. So that was the idea. That's how it was born.
And there's a master's program where these people probably can enroll?
Yes.
Yes, there is a master's program available at DYPDC. Any aspiring designers,
yes,
you're welcome there.
Yes.
And you can see him again there every 2-3 months.
Yes.
All right, sir. Many questions, many queries, many curious people over here. But as you said, time is always a problem. So with this, people, we come to the end of the fireside chat with the one and only Dilip Chhabria.